What does a circle, a power station, a 1980s stereo, and a snare drum all have in common? Well, they are things that I can use to explain to you one of the most misunderstood, yet vitally important parts of audio and sound, phase. Let's just dive straight in. So let me start by showing you just how serious phase can be. I've got an audio demo that I'm playing at the top here. And I've now duplicated that exactly sample for sample onto the channel underneath. Now, obviously, it's gotten louder. And when you add two identical pieces of audio at the same volume level together, the level jump is 6 dB. Okay, now I'm going to take this utility plugin that's on this second channel, and I'm going to phase invert both channels, left and right. Now let's play both these channels combined. Absolutely nothing. Now watch this. As I slowly pull down the fader of the inverted phase channel, listen to the audio come back. So let's be clear. A fully phase inverted signal at an identical volume level to the original will completely remove the audio. And I can show you that just by quickly bouncing the two down. The resulting file is completely empty. But now let's do something interesting. What happens if I pan the original file to the left and the phase inverted file to the right? Have a listen to this. It's playing back, but it's incredibly unsettling. So basically what we have now, the left-hand channel is in phase as per the original audio, and the right-hand channel is phase inverted. Now, if I bring the original back to the center and then pan the inverted signal back to the center, it will disappear again. Now I'm going to take this inverted audio file and I'm going to move its position as it plays back. Watch this. So the audio is starting to play again, but it's got this very weird comb filtering type effect to it. And if you look at the start positions, you can see I've only moved it a tiny amount. Now let's pan both of those signals left and right and see what we get. So the audio was coming back, but it sounded an awful lot wider than the original. So now I've returned both audio sections to exactly the same start point, and I've applied this very simple delay to the inverted phase channel. The delay is set to samples as a unit, and I'm going to automate it slightly from all the way down to zero, just up to a few hundred. We've basically created a phaser effect. Now, if I unlink the channels, I can automate the delay values by different amounts. Listen to this. We've created a stereo phaser. So why does this one principle phase have such a big effect on audio? I mean, we're talking about the potential removal of an audio source should it go 180 degrees out of phase. Well, to answer this, we're going to have to ask two more questions. What is sound and what is audio? Let's start with sound. Now, here I'm using something we all understand. A speaker, its sole purpose is to make a noise. I've superglued a party straw to the middle of this speaker, not only to show you its motion because it's Friday here and we're friggin' animals at F9, you should see our range of party plates. So right now it's in its default or zero position. It's a speaker in a room surrounded by air. Air that is made up of billions of gas particles and molecules like water, oxygen, nitrogen, etc. Let's put a simple sine wave through it. When a positive voltage is applied to the electrical connections of the speaker, it moves forward from its zero position, pushing the air out of the way in front of it. This causes a local change in the air pressure. The pressure in front of the speaker increases, and this pressure wave radiates out into the room. as the audio signal coming into the speaker goes the other way on this second part, or second phase, shall we say, of the wave, the voltage turns negative. The speaker cone now moves backwards, passes back through the zero point and into its casing. This causes an air pressure drop in front of the speaker. So the sine wave gets turned into these pressure waves in the air. These differences between higher and lower pressure, which will traverse the room at the speed of sound. They eventually make it into our ears and make our eardrums vibrate. Now, through a frankly amazing piece of evolutionary biology, this gets sent via a chain of tiny bones into the cochlea, where the tiny hairs vibrate and turn the sound into nerve signals for the brain to translate. It's always mind-blowing to me to think that all of the immense detail we hear in our lives and music comes from this process. It's also why there's no sound in space. There's no air to carry the pressure waves. Let's just pull back for a minute and start to visualize this. In the room around you, have a think about the air. We all know it's made up of tiny little invisible gas particles, but think of them all just floating around and jiggling a little bit. Now, when a sound wave comes up that is effectively a pressure wave, the high pressure at the front of the wave pushes all the air particles together, but they're still jiggling. And then as the second part of the wave, the low pressure comes in, suddenly there's tons and tons of room. Everything gets spread out. Then they all go kind of back to normal. Now, the jiggling's important to understand because what I'm talking about there effectively is how hot that individual particle is. Now, why is this important? Well, think about all these air particles floating around and getting squashed together and then relaxing. They will collide with each other. And every time there's a collision, some of the energy of that wave is transferred into heat. This means that some of the energy will get lost. And what's really important here to understand is that the high frequencies, the top end, fall off quicker over distance. It's easier for the particles to actually absorb that information. Now, if you want a practical example of this actually in action, think of lightning and thunderclaps. Now, I actually witnessed a lightning strike about 30 foot in front of me. Luckily, I was inside, so I wasn't in any danger, but I cannot tell you how bright that sound was as the air around the lightning strike literally exploded. But when you're 5 miles out from a thunderstorm, all you hear is a little bit of a crack, but this great big low rumble. And that is because of this principle that we're talking about here. The high-end information over a distance will get absorbed by the air around it. Now, this is so important when it actually comes to physical spaces because the top end falls away much quicker, but the bass carries on. And this is why bass in studios and production rooms is so important when it comes to phase cancellation. So now let's move on to audio. Audio, to me anyway, is sound converted to electrical signals, whether that be analog or digital signals. To record acoustic sounds, we use microphones like the one I'm using to record this voiceover. It's converting the pressure waves coming out of my mouth into electrical signals. To turn this into digital information, we use converter boxes like this SSL2 I'm using to record my voiceover. It amplifies the continuous analog signal going into it and converts it into a stream of numbers at a given clock rate. Now, each number effectively represents the pressure of the air surrounding my microphone at an entirely tiny slice of time. We can also create digital audio inside computers using maths, and that's how every single VST sampler and synth operates. What is key to understand in all of this computer-based signal processing and generation, though, is that we are working in the same framework as the first part of this video. A zero point in the middle, with the audio and sound oscillating between positive and negative values. Now, it's easy to forget this whilst working inside a DAW, but eventually the digital signals will leave your computer or iPad or phone, get converted back into voltages and currents that drive and move speakers that push air again, and sound can then travel into your ears. We have complicated all of this by creating a stereo system for music. This means two speakers to match our two ears, pumping out sounds and music, and a stereo field to mix in. Now, obviously, the pressure waves from multiple sources will come together and interact. If the pressure wave from one speaker reaches a certain point in space and it's positive pressure, but is met then by a negative pressure wave, the two can cancel each other out. And this is our first realization of how phase can affect the real world. In the 80s, hi-fi systems, as they were called then, needed putting together by hand. I always remember the high street brand Dixon's having 20 or so of them all lined up in store. The manufacturers went to great lengths to label the amplifier outputs, say red or black. There's a 50% chance of wiring such a stereo up inversely, and 50% of the stereos I heard being demoed in Dixon's had one speaker 180 degrees out of phase. So whilst one speaker was pushing the air, the other speaker was actually pulling the air. This would cause a horrible stereo image. They sounded terrible. When recording acoustic drums, it's common to mic both the top and bottom of a snare drum. The bottom contains the metal snares that gives it its unique snap, and this can be vital in a drum recording. Now, I need you to visualize this instrument. A snare drum is effectively a sealed unit with drum skins top and bottom. And when the drumstick comes down hard on the top skin, the air pressure pushes the bottom skin down at the same time. This means a microphone at the top will experience low pressure, while the microphone at the bottom will experience higher pressure. Their signals are nearly perfectly phase inverted. So to compensate for this, the preamp connected to the bottom microphone should have its phase inversion switch enabled. This will allow the top and bottom microphone signals to be blended without issue. If this is not engaged, they will combine destructively, particularly in the bottom end where the most energy and bigger wavelengths live. Sound can take many forms, but we only as humans hear it as a pitch or a musical note when it's cyclic, in other words, when it repeats over time. And this can be generated from string, this can be generated from metal tubes, this can be generated by a human voice, or a synthesizer and a pile of Eurorack. Now, many years back, a very clever French maths genius called Fourier created a series and a theorem that allowed us to describe any complex wave as a series of simpler waves, in fact, the simplest, sine waves. Now, let's call these individual parts partials. This kind of maths is absolutely perfect for audio, and you may have already heard of fast Fourier transforms, or FFT, and any audio analyzer or spectral process that you use as a plugin will use Fourier's maths. Musical notes nearly always contain one prominent partial, and we call this the fundamental harmonic. In most cases, it is the lowest, and if you were to see all of the amplitudes of the different partials on a graph, it would probably be the highest. This is vital in our understanding and controlling of phase. Now, have you ever wondered why phase is described in degrees? I'm sure we can all remember from secondary school maths that there are 360 degrees in a circle. So, how is phase related to a circle? Let me show you. So, here is a perfect visual explanation of the relationship between a circle spinning at a constant speed and a sine wave. To me, it's fascinating that two of the simplest shapes in our modern lives come from the same source. Now, as you can see, the amplitude of the sine wave changes over time. The height of the output in relation to the central zero point is directly related to this movement around the circle. Let's just stop everything and look at the circle right at the top, 0 degrees. The sine wave output is at its top. Now let's rotate 180 degrees around the circle. This throws the sine wave output all the way to its lowest point. Now here are two signals, 180 degrees apart, playing together. They match movements perfectly, as you can see, but are completely inverted from one another. Here it's easy to see that if you were to add these together, you will get absolutely nothing, just as I showed you right at the start. Let's now take another example and tap three separate sine wave outputs, equally spaced around a circle 120 degrees apart. 360 divided by 3 is 120. Each signal is in effect a delayed version of the one before it. Phase is always a function of time. Now, this arrangement is used every single day by the national grids around the world. You may have actually heard of three-phase power, and depending on where you live or work, your building may even have it supplied. In a nutshell, the enormous turbines in power stations are tapped at three points equidistant from each other to pull off three different AC phases. All of the plug sockets in your home and studio kick out AC power, which is a sine wave, and this is why. In the UK, it's actually very normal to see pylons with three arms. These carry a double set of three-phase power, three phases on each side of the pylon with a common earth wire right at the top. Now let's get back to audio, and there's one more thing to really grasp. Phase interactions are at their absolute peak when the tones are tuned identically together. Tune any of the sources away from each other and the interactions change really quickly. Here's a perfect example. I've got two instances here of Massive X. They are both playing only one oscillator, but the audio engine in Massive is set to phase reset the oscillators at every key push. That means every time a note is played, the phase of the oscillators is reset identically on both synths. That will give us two perfectly phase-locked signals. Here's the first instance of Massive X. And now the second. Here's both of them playing together. As expected, you get a 60 dB level jump upwards. Both sources are at the same level and phase locked. Now let's phase invert the second instance of Massive X. As expected, complete cancellation. I've got one of Massive X's macros set to detune the oscillators just by a tiny amount. Now look at what happens when I automate that across time. The sound quickly comes back, and although it's thin at the beginning, it quickly settles into that detuned oscillator sound that we all know and love. Also, don't forget that phase is a function of time, so if we slip one of these sources backwards and forwards, the interactions will also change. So why is phase so important to the bass end of your production? Well, it's all because of the way that your ears operate. Earlier, we talked about how top end falls off or decays over distance. Now, in our human experience, energy carried on the waves increases as you go down the frequencies from high to low. Now, like everything in audio, this is not a straight line. Our lowest octaves can have extreme amounts of energy carried on their wavefronts, and it's one of the reasons why our modern kick drums and basses take up so much room in our mixes, and you can even see this visually on the waveforms. As we go under, say, 60 hertz, our relationship with pitch changes dramatically, and this is because we can't physically vocalize with our throats frequencies at that level, so our brain kind of starts to filter them out. And here's the most important point. In the real subsonics, the energy carried on the wave is so big and the waveforms are so long that phase is absolutely king down there. Now, hopefully this visual example will show you why. I've recorded a series of sine waves in from Logic's test oscillator. This is 50 hertz, 100 hertz, and 1000 hertz, or 1 kilohertz. Then what I've done is copied the waveforms underneath and shifted it so that the bottom waveform is 180 degrees out of phase, as we showed before. Now, obviously, in a linear sequencer like that, time runs from left to right. So what we can see here is a visual representation of how far you have to shift the waveform for it to go out of phase. So for 50 hertz, you have to shift it this amount. For 100 hertz, you have to shift it this amount. But for 1 kilohertz, you only have to shift it by this one little slither for it to go out of phase. This all occurs because of the actual wavelength. So here's one cycle. I've cut it out here. You can see it takes up this entire space. 100 hertz, which is double 50 hertz, takes up exactly half of that. But 1 kilohertz is a tiny little slither. And that means to come out of phase problems, you've only got to shift a frequency up there by a tiny, tiny amount. Whereas you've got to move it an awful long way for the phase cancellation to stop at the bass end. And this is exactly why you will run into more problems in the bass end, because this is compounded by the fact that there is more energy in the bass end. So it's time to wrap this video up because it's getting quite long. Next time, I'm going to show you as many tricks and tips related to phase as I can possibly throw at you. So that's it for this video, and thank you so much for watching, and I truly hope it started to demystify phase, one of the most complex issues in audio and very, very misunderstood. Now, don't worry if you don't get this straight up. I find sometimes that it takes three goes to actually get something in. So really come back to this and study this kind of concept a couple of times and make your own investigations inside your DAW as well. We're going to be covering an awful lot more on the Bass Sense, so do watch out for the other videos. Obviously, like, subscribe, all that jazz, and we'll see you next time.